You know, the president has a duty to enforce the laws. If he is seeking to unravel and uncover fraudulent votes, he has immunity to do so. Mm-hmm. I think that'll be a motion to dismiss. And I think it's actually a serious motion to be made.
You just saw GREGG JARRETT, who's a longtime Fox News legal analyst and commentator, claiming that Trump had complete immunity to try and overthrow our country's democracy. He was simply executing his duties as president. Now, JARRETT was referring to the racketeering charges that Fani Willis has brought against Trump, just in case you couldn't tell which one of the numerous indictments against him he was referring to. Now, of course, his argument is absolutely absurd. So let's break down why it's wrong as quickly as possible so we don't waste too much time on this moron. So number one, Trump wasn't seeking to unravel or uncover fraudulent votes. He was trying to intimidate elected officials into changing votes into his favor. And second, by the time of Trump's now infamous call to Brad Raffensperger, the Georgia Secretary of State's office had already conducted 3 vote counts, all of which found that Trump lost. But if you thought that was the only spineless defense of Trump we'd have for you, you would be wrong. Here's more from Fox News contributor Jonathan Turley.
But in Donald Trump's case, he insists that he does believe that Georgia could have been flipped with a recount. And the way that she portrayed that phone call to Raffensperger, I think is really evidence of the bias and unfairness of aspects of this indictment. You know, it makes perfect sense when you're challenging an election to say, you know, I only need around 11,000 votes. So if you do a statewide review, that's not a lot in a state like Georgia. That's not criminal. That's making a case for a recount.
I mean, we've already made it clear why Trump was not simply asking for a recount, because he quite literally was not asking for a recount. But Cenk, if this is the best argument that cable news has, things don't look good for Donald Trump.
Look, GREGG JARRETT is a troubled man. We've covered his troubles before. I'm not surprised that he has idiotic legal theories, which I'll break down in a second. But Jonathan Turley, oh man, his fall has been really heartbreaking. So Turley is this sophisticated, intelligent guy. Back in the day when Keith Olbermann was around, he'd have him on MSNBC all the time, and he'd break down the crimes of George Bush and Dick Cheney. I'm not saying that Turley's gone in the wrong direction just because he seems to be a huge Trump fan and is on Fox News 24/7 defending Donald Trump. Look, sometimes he makes legal arguments where I go, okay, it's not crazy, it's a stretch, but I get it. He's a lawyer and he likes Trump and he's doing an argument that's a stretch. In this case, he had a tweet that was the exact opposite of what he just said on air just a little while ago. So something happened to Turley. I don't know if his mind broke. Sometimes this happens. Like, people get so mad at the establishment and the lies of the establishment that they decide they're gonna go crazy in the opposite direction and be like, yeah, Trump's awesome. The guy who's a perpetual liar and a lifelong criminal is the good guy. No, you could hate the establishment and notice their lies and realize that Trump's lying too. That argument was preposterous. So if they had done no recounts, and I've said this now many times, and Trump called and said, hey, can you guys do a recount? Are you kidding me? That's not a crime at all. That's not within a million miles of a crime. But when they have already done 2-3 recounts, they've done a hand recount, and you go, I don't give a damn about your recounts, and I don't care who won, find me 11,780 votes, one more than I need. And how do you explain the fake electors? They had them sign forged documents pretending to be the real electors. Yeah, that's a crime. That's an obvious crime. And Jonathan Turley knows that. So him humiliating himself, debasing himself on Fox News is one of the saddest things I've ever seen. So now back to the moron GREGG JARRETT. I think when a president is trying to, you know, I would say steal an election, but in his case, you know, stop a steal, then he has immunity. Really? Immunity from what? From what, all crimes? Is that a thing? So can the president say, well, I thought I won, but the recounts show that Joe Biden won, and so do the original accounts. But you know what? In my mind, I'm trying to steal an election. I'm sorry, stop the stealing of an election. You know what? So I'm going to go shoot Joe Biden in the head. Could Trump do that if he has immunity? Oh, you didn't think it through, did you, Greg? And there's many reasons why Greg might not have thought it through. But no, there is no such law as blanket immunity for a president when he's trying to, you know, defend his vote count in an election. He pulled that straight out of his ass. But the problem with the viewers of conservative channels is that they believe every word that every dumbass on those channels says. So now I guarantee you, you'll see tons of people on the right going, the president has total immunity. When he thinks he's right, he can do anything he wants, he can break any law. The national secrets, by the way, already declassified them with his laser eyes, and he thought about it, and now he has immunity for all crimes. What can you do when people are not attached to the reality-based world? I mean, there's no arguing with these idiots. Jordan.
I mean, just to add some context, in the span of time between when the first recount started and when Trump asked for this, Dave Weigel with Semaphore articulated exactly when these things happened. November 11th, Raffensperger started the audit. It finished on the 19th. The election was certified for Biden on November 20th. 21st, Trump requested a recount. Biden won that recount on December 7th. The electors voted on December 14th. And then on January 2nd, Trump made that call asking them to find votes. I mean, this was settled. This was a done deal multiple times. And for all of this talk, all of this hyperbolic language you see from the right about Obama and Biden being authoritarians, every little thing they do, big or small, is some authoritative act, and they're violating the Constitution, and everything they do brings us closer to an authoritarian state. Where, look, right here, you're calling for a president, and now in this case, a former president, to be able to do whatever they want, no matter what, no legal barriers, no boundaries. For all of this concern, this purported concern about authoritarianism and in the executive branch, that goes out the window when it's their guy. And this is extremely dangerous when you have a party who thinks like that, and you have messaging from the most watched cable network that appeals to that party parroting that language. This is extremely dangerous because millions of people tune in every night and they internalize it. And their view of politics and their view of our society becomes, if it's my guy doing it, I don't care.
I want to clarify one other part of that call that's so important. He threatened to imprison Raffensperger. He said, look, what you're doing could be criminal. So what, Greg Jarrett, is that also, does he have immunity on that? What if he had actually put him in prison? Oh, I didn't like your recount. I didn't like that you were accurate about it. I told you to find me votes I don't have, and you didn't find them, so now you're in prison. Oh, by the way, I executed you. Does he have immunity for that too? Look, Al Gore had an election absolutely positively stolen from him by the Supreme Court. But that was the court's decision. And the Democrats said, we're gonna abide by it. Because what else are you gonna do? You're gonna start a civil war? You're gonna commit also criminal acts? The Supreme Court ruled it sucks. And they were total and utter liars. And they literally stopped the recount. Not the count, but the recount of Florida. And it turns out afterwards they did a recount in Florida, and Al Gore had won. Al Gore had actually won. But if Al Gore came to me and said, hey, should we do a recount? I'd be like, hell yeah. Should we fight like hell for a recount? Hell yeah. Should we do a hand recount? Hell yeah. But if he said, should we do fake electors and have them sign fake papers and then pretend I won? I would say, no, don't do that. That's obviously illegal. If he said, should we threaten to imprison people, you know, state officials in Florida if they don't do what I tell them? Because at the time, remember, Al Gore is the vice president of the United States of America. He could have done similar things to as Trump did. I'd be like, are you kidding me? You're gonna threaten to imprison people? No, don't do that. That's definitely illegal. But there is no such thing on the right wing. Nothing, nothing. Whoever is like had any ounce of credibility, principles, was an actual conservative and understood what it meant to be a conservative and cared about the US Constitution and law and order. Any of those things, they've already left. It was like 3% of the Republican Party and they left. The rest of them are like, Constitution, as long as Trump wants to burn it. Remember, Trump literally said that he wants to suspend the Constitution. Would he have immunity for that too, Greg Jarrett? And you know he would. In Greg Jarrett's mind, in Jonathan Turley's mind, burn the Constitution. Say it no longer exists. We're not going to have elections anymore. And they'd be like, yes, because Trump did it. It must be right. That's when you know you've lost your goddamn mind.
Conveniently, Fox News never covers that part of the phone call when they do their little shtick about, oh, Trump just said we need this many votes. He wasn't asking anybody to actually do anything. And speaking of the messaging around this, we talked about the way that cable news is portraying it. Let's talk about the way that Trump is defending himself against these indictments. Let's start with this video.
I mean, I have counts where you're going to love this, and Chris Ruddy will be thrilled. But one of the things is I told people, Newsmax. Did you know that? That was one of my counts. I told people to watch Newsmax.
We love it, sir. We love it, Mr.
People to watch Newsmax.
Thank you for that.
I hope you don't get charged. You'll probably get charged because I mentioned your name. But I think you'll be okay.
I feel like it goes without saying, but I'm going to say it anyway. No, absolutely. That is 100% untrue. None of Trump's counts are for watching Newsmax. Although, you know, maybe there's an argument to be made that Newsmax should not be allowed to be watched in this country. But no, anyway, Newsmax is mentioned. And the reason that he's presenting this argument is because it's mentioned in the context of Trump's first count, violation of the Georgia RICO Act. The count lists 161 acts of racketeering activity. Newsmax comes up in exactly one of those. So let's take a look from the indictment. It says, on or about the 30th day of December 2020, Donald John Trump caused to be tweeted from the Twitter account at Real Donald Trump. Hearings from Atlanta on the Georgia election overturn now being broadcast. Check it out. At One America News Network, at Newsmax, and many more. At Brian Kemp, Georgia should resign from office. He is an obstructionist who refuses to admit that we won Georgia big. Also won the other swing states. This was an overt act in furtherance of the conspiracy. So clearly not being indicted for telling people to watch Newsmax. And it has everything to do with the context in which he suggested that. Now, I mean, one of the things I want to know, you know, about this election, you know, the furtherance of the election conspiracy, I think that especially when it comes to the voting machines, so many of the other news sites and news outlets distance themselves from that. But every time I see, you know, a clip from Newsmax or a clip from what is the other one, Right Side Broadcasting Network, that's all they seem to be talking about. I mean, is there not any like accountability for these networks that continue to spread these lies, Cenk? I don't know. That's just my takeaway from this.
Well, Fox News is now a little bit more mixed, as we've covered. And the other day they were praising Nikki Haley, who had taken on Donald Trump in that Republican debate. Obviously, she took him on in absentia. He wasn't there, but she made some pretty harsh comments about him. And why is that? Partly because Rupert Murdoch now hates him. And he owns Fox News, but also part of the reason Rupert Murdoch hates him because he cost him $800 million. In order to appease Donald Trump, they told a whole bunch of lies about the election and Dominion made them pay for it in that giant settlement. Newsmax and OAN have not, I don't know what OAN's situation is, but Newsmax has not settled with Dominion yet and they have not gone to court yet. So look, if the settlement or the, you know, the jury comes in with a verdict even a quarter of what Fox News paid, Newsmax is out of business. There's no way in the world they can afford that. So whether it's those lies or the new lies, at some point, someone's gonna try to hold them accountable in court and we're gonna see if these guys exist after that. And so, but Greg Kelly cracks me up, man. So he's like over the moon with Donald Trump. He's like a little boy, right? And in other segments, he acts like a tough guy. But when Trump's on, he's like, Donald, yes, Donald. And when he was on, we showed the clip earlier in the show, when Donald Trump came back on Twitter, the guy nearly lost it in his pants. He's just back on Twitter, so what? He acted like he had won the presidency or something. So yeah, there's several networks now whose only job is to fluff Donald Trump. And yeah, that works for the moment being. It gets them enough money to exist because there's a lot of folks on the right wing who's in the fluffing business. But I think the time's going to run out on it through the lawsuits, but we'll see.
Yeah, I think that's exactly right. They're all vying for the disillusioned Fox viewer, because for people who are fully in the Trump camp, any detraction from that or any other commentary that could question some of Trump's claims or distance themselves from Trump, those viewers are going to be upset because it just completely changes the paradigm for them. They don't want to acknowledge that. They don't want to think about any criticism. They don't want to hear it. So they'll go somewhere else, and those networks are rabid. I mean, One American News, I think that's the network that was pulled from Dish Network because they were going for executions of people who stood in the way of the certification of Biden's election in 2020. I mean, that is fully deranged, and I think that's a smart move by DirecTV for just cutting them loose because it was just a total liability. But as those networks vie for those viewers, part of that is just, like you're saying, Cenk, fluffing Trump, being totally subservient to him, defending everything he says and does. And that's fan service for the crowds, that's fan service for the audience. And when you mix in some of these deranged conspiracy theories, that's where you're going to get the more, the bigger lunacy fringe that in real life acts out acts of violence, stochastic terrorism, bomb threats when they see stories about, trans care at children's hospitals or teachers in random public schools who just acknowledge that people with other sexualities or identities exist. I mean, those networks, in part by courting Trump and fluffing him, there are real world consequences to that. That Fox has even taken a tiny bit of moderation into account over the past couple of years has led to really disastrous consequences.
Yeah, one last quick thing on it. Look, guys, we also shouldn't fall into the same trap. And so at TYT, we're super clear. We criticize everyone when they deserve it. Doesn't matter, Republican, Democrat. You see us do it every day, 12 times a day, right? But at MSNBC, have you ever seen them criticize Democratic leaders? So we should be better than that. And so everybody gets into their camps and think that they don't do anything wrong. And I've seen mainstream media criticize Republicans for taking corporate money. I've almost never seen them criticize Democrats for taking the same exact corporate money. So while we're rightfully pointing out the cult over there, no one should form a cult anywhere else, including on the left or the Democratic Party or anywhere else.
Thanks for watching the Young Turks, really appreciate it. Another way to show support is through YouTube memberships. You'll get to interact with us more. There's live chat, emojis, badges. You've got emojis of me, Anna, John, JR. So those are super fun. But you also get playback of our exclusive member only shows and specials right after they air. So all of that, all you gotta do is click that join button right underneath the video. Thank you.